Good morning and welcome everyone here in church. Welcome to you wherever you are in time and space. We're just here in this location gathering now to find our seats and get started in our worship time. We don't need to be in the same place, do we, to be one church. We are one church in the Lord Jesus Christ, who makes us one. We are one in Him. The Spirit connects us wherever we are, in time or space. And it's this church mission that we are a part of. That's we have a sermon series at the moment, and we are in our second week of that series. Last week we heard about the church being sent, and this week we're going to hear about the church being confident. And Mary will speak to that theme in a little bit. So I'd just like us to take a time of quiet reflection just as we get started. How confident have you come into worship this morning? How confident do you feel wherever you are? Today's scripture says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I'm not ashamed. It's what gives, it's the righteousness. The gospel is the righteousness of God. It's what's good about being alive. Let's just connect with that goodness this morning before we worship. Our good God is creative, He's personal, He's powerful, and He's gracious. Let's worship Him now.
Let's start. From the highest of heights. From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing Your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that is. Where it should go.
Such is your greatness, you flung stars into space. You create the world for your purposes, but yet you come to us personally in your still quiet voice. You come by your Spirit because of what Jesus has done for us. By your Spirit, you fan your creation within us. And so, Father, we pray that you continue now as we wait upon your word, that you would continue to recreate and create in us the world that you wanted to create from the very beginning. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Bible reading is taken from Romans chapter 1, verses 8 to 17. This is Paul's longing to visit Rome. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world. God, whom I serve in my spirit in preaching the gospel of his Son, is my witness how constantly I remember you in my prayers at all times. And I pray that now at last, by God's will, the way may be opened for me to come to you. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong, that is, that you and I may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers and sisters, that I planned many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I have had among the other Gentiles. I am a debtor to both Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. For in the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteousness will live by faith. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh, good morning. We're in the second week of our sermon series on living a mission-shaped life. And the topic for today is confidence. And you might have noticed in that last verse, Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. Well, confidence. What does that word mean? Well, it has to do with belief and trust and faith. We may say of someone that they or she lacks self-confidence, meaning that they don't believe in themselves, or there's something they particularly know that they can't do, or at least they don't believe they can do it. And I can give you an example of that in my own experience. A few weeks ago, I went to visit a friend in the Netherlands. And before I went, she asked if it would be all right if she borrowed her sister's bicycle for me to ride. As you probably know, in the Netherlands, everyone goes by bike. They've got very well-established cycle tracks, safe cycle tracks off main roads, although there are some busy junctions. So I said, I'm not a very confident cyclist. I said, when I have to do hand signals, I wobble terribly. I've got to hang on with both hands, and of course, with hand signals, you've got to let go. And I have been known to fall off at a junction, actually. But on quiet cycle paths, I might manage. Well, I was very relieved when she decided that that was probably not such a good idea, and that we would walk or drive to various places. I'm certainly confident on two feet, but I'm not confident on two wheels. Well, in the passage we've just read, Paul is brimming with confidence, belief, faith and trust, not in himself, but in the gospel. That word is found several times in this passage. Now, the word gospel means good news. And that's exactly what it is, which gives Paul such confidence in sharing it. And he's full of positive words, thankful for the believers in Rome, whom he has yet to meet, because they have come to faith through other believers, not through him, but he wants to meet them face to face. And we may remember how Paul himself had his life transformed by the power of God. He was a fierce opponent of the Christian faith until he had an encounter with Jesus on the road to Damascus, which completely transformed him and turned his life round and convinced him of the power of God, the power of the gospel to change lives. And I think perhaps some of us, if any of us, have had a dramatic or maybe less dramatic but very real experience of God, then we have no doubt about the power of it, and we are confident that it's God at work. Well, since that time, Paul has devoted his life to sharing the good news of Jesus. But he's also humble enough, as we see in verse 12, to recognize that he also has something to receive. He's not just going to give and teach, but he's also going to receive and learn from other people. And I think that's one lesson we can learn from this passage. We need each other's help and encouragement wherever we are in our Christian journey. We're never too old in the faith or too mature not to need help and encouragement from other people. And likewise, we're never too young in the faith to give words of encouragement as well. We're all there for each other to help and support each other. And Paul recognized this. He was, as it were, a father of the Christian faith, but he still needed and appreciated the help of others. Well, then verse 15 got me thinking, because Paul said he's eager to preach the gospel to you, that is to his readers, to the Romans, They're described as the saints in Rome in verse 7, which was not in the passage we read. But that's an interesting point. A saint is a believer in the New Testament sense, not an extra holy person, but a believer in Jesus. We're all saints in the sight of God. So he's eager to preach the gospel to them, and yet they're clearly already believers from the context of this passage. Haven't they already heard it and responded in faith to the gospel? And as I was thinking about this, I thought, well, yes, the gospel, the good news about Jesus, is not just the initial coming to faith, what Jesus did on the cross, important though that is. The good news of Jesus is an ongoing work in our lives. God's will for us, his desire for us, is healing and wholeness and well-being. And that's a process that can take many, many years. I have some friends who are sort of my age, so we've been around a bit. but I'm sure there are other younger ones as well, who are still dealing with issues from their childhood. Painful memories, painful experiences from childhood or much earlier in their lives. And it's at this relatively late stage in their lives that they're aware that God, that that's not just how they are and they've got to put up with it, but God wants to bring healing and wholeness and well-being into their lives. So the gospel is not just to do with an initial decision to follow Jesus, but surely it's God's desire, his good news, to heal us, to make us whole. But we need to remember, of course, that does not mean a trouble-free life. We will have, in this world, we have many troubles. We have problems. We have issues to deal with, which is different. And God never guarantees that we'll have a trouble-free life. But healing and wholeness and working towards that is something which, by God's Holy Spirit, he gives us the resources to do. Well, moving on to verses 16 and 17, the last two verses of the passage we're looking at this morning. Well, my study Bible comments that these two verses describe the theme of the entire book of Romans, which is all 16 chapters. And actually, many books have been written just on the teaching found in these verses. So I shall try to condense it and just be very selective in what I'm going to say here. Well, Paul, as we've seen, is not ashamed of the gospel, but he boldly shares this good news wherever he is. And if we read the book of Acts, we'll see how he moves from place to place with companions, boldly sharing the good news of Jesus. Sometimes it's received, sometimes it isn't. Sometimes people welcome him, sometimes they drive him out. You know, he has a tough time, but he is so convinced of the truth of it that he will not give up. Why is that? Why does he have this confidence to keep on? Because he knows it's not an idea that he has dreamed up, but its source is God. It's God's idea to save people, to transform people who believe and accept the good news of Jesus. And for us today, as we formally or very informally through informal conversations share with others what God means to us and something about our Christian lives, God is with us, whether we realize it or not. God's power is at work through us. Some will hear and respond, some will not. But when we speak in Jesus' name about our faith in a gentle, winsome way, we hope, God will be at work in some way. And we can have confidence that God will speak through us as we speak. And now verse 17 particularly, this is the source of Paul's confidence. And I want to read this in the New Living Translation. It puts it like this. This gospel, this good news, it says here, this good news tells us how God makes us right in his sight. It is accomplished from start to finish by faith. As the scriptures say, it is through faith that a righteous person has life. In other words, We can't earn our way into God's good books by trying to live a good life, because we'll never manage it. God doesn't intend it that way. Rather, it's by focusing on what Jesus has done on our behalf through his life, his death on the cross, and his rising again. In the Old Testament, we tend to think, oh, the Old Testament's full of laws and rules and regulations and thou shalt not. But not so. There are examples in the Old Testament, in the Jewish scriptures, of joyful annual festivals such as Passover and the Feast of Tabernacles and other celebrations where people had wonderful food and drink. They celebrated God's love and God's goodness, secure in their relationship with God. But also, alongside that, they offered different sacrifices in order to deal with the bad stuff that they knew was going on in their lives, the guilt of their wrongdoing, and recognize that in this way, as well as by trying to live by God's laws, they could deal with and put right their relationship with God and maintain a good relationship with him. And now this all pointed to the coming of Jesus. By his life, Jesus showed us how to live for others. And by his death, he offered himself in our place as a sacrifice for the bad stuff, the guilt of our wrongdoing. And as we believe that for ourselves, and thus have faith in what Jesus has done for us, so God counts us as right in his sight. We don't need to offer sacrifices anymore, because Jesus has offered himself on our behalf and in our place. And by rising from the dead, Jesus leads the way for us to know that we too have eternal life, which begins when we start that journey of faith with Jesus and will continue on through our physical death into eternity. Well, that's a little taster of what the book of Romans actually is all about. That's encapsulated into this little verse 17. It's a great book to read. It's hard work, but if you do feel like tackling a challenge, the book of Romans with a good commentary is wonderful in explaining really what Jesus has come to do for us. So, Paul says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. He has confidence in the power of the gospel to transform lives. His life's been transformed. He's seen that at work in others. Well, what about us? Are we as confident as Paul about the truth of the gospel, the good news of Jesus? Well, first of all, do we ourselves actually believe it? Do we know God at work in our lives, changing us bit by bit as time goes by? Not an instant overnight transformation for most people. That may be for some a very different, distinct change of direction. But then it's generally a change in our lives, in our outlook, in our relationships, a quality of our relationships. If that is not your experience, if you're not sure, please do talk to someone who you know is a Christian, who is surely a follower of Jesus, to explain more of what it means to follow Jesus. And yet we have to remember too, even as Christians, it's not easy to follow Jesus. Paul didn't find it easy. Paul prayed or asked his readers to pray for him for courage to share the good news. And how much more do we also need that? It's not easy for us to share the Christian faith in our society. It's true we're not like some in, for example, I think if any of you are aware of Open Doors, the charity that Christian charity that works to defend and support Christians in countries where there is extreme persecution. Afghanistan and North Korea are the countries where Christians are most in danger and most severely persecuted for their Christian faith. parts of the Middle East as well. We don't suffer that sort of persecution or life-threatening situation. But we may be ridiculed, we may be mocked for our beliefs. On Easter Sunday, I was actually leading the 9 o'clock service, and so I chose the liturgy. And I chose one which, in part of the confession, had these words. Like the disciples behind locked doors, we are afraid to be seen as your followers. Christ, have mercy. And I use a prayer guide for university students, and we're often asked to pray that they'll have courage to share the good news of Jesus with their fellow students. And you can imagine, in a university situation, it's pretty tough. But there again, it's a place where people explore new ideas. I became a Christian at university. For me, it was a very positive experience. But it's also a pretty tough environment. It can work both ways. We can assume that people won't be interested or will mock us. But it can be surprising how often people, if we explain something about our faith and don't preach at them, people will see the positive difference it makes to us and can make for them. If we share something about our personal experience of life in the workplace, in the home, in various situations, church life, that can be something which is very positive and appealing to people. Now, I'm not saying we don't talk about Jesus and the cross. Our faith rests on what Jesus has done for us on the cross. That's absolutely the central thing. But it isn't necessarily the first thing to talk about when sharing our faith. It will need to come later if someone is interested and wants to know what it really means to be a Christian. The cross of Christ is absolutely central. Well, I'd like to just close by just sharing one or two contemporary examples to encourage us about how to have confidence in the gospel. I get some information from the Bible Society, which I support. And there's been quite a lot about the work of the Bible Society in Syria, of all places. You think, yes, there are Christians in Syria. There's an active Bible Society in Syria. In Damascus and Aleppo and Homs, there are centres of Bible distribution and teaching, which is flourishing. Many people are wanting portions of scripture and want to know more about the Christian faith, including those not from a Christian background, and they want to establish a new centre in northeast Syria, which is quite a tricky place to be. And there are other examples around the world where, we would say unexpectedly, but in God's mercy, God is at work and giving people a hunger to know more about Jesus. You may know in parts of the Middle East that where so-called closed countries, God reveals himself, Jesus reveals himself through dreams and visions, and these are very, very well documented, where it's not possible to get through in normal human ways, God can work in supernatural ways to bring people to Jesus. And this is the last example I want to give you. I have got here, for any of you who are keen gardeners, or even if you're not, you'll have heard, I'm sure, of the Chelsea Flower Show. I don't know if any of you went to it last year. it was postponed until, I think, September. But the Bible Society sponsored a garden at the Chelsea Flower Show, based on Psalm 23. You know, the Lord is my shepherd, I will lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. And then there's that bit about walking through the valley of the shadow of death. It's a very interesting landscape described. And it's a landscape that pictorially describes our lives. And this was constructed as a garden in the Chelsea Flower Show, and it won a gold medal. But more important than that, let me just read a little bit about what it says here. In an age when, in the West at least, scripture is often ignored or forgotten, the Psalm 23 garden was a way of saying to huge numbers of people, The Bible has something to say to you today. Its depiction of the green pastures and quiet waters spoke of the times of rest we experience in our lives, and particularly of the healing power of God's creation. The whole garden spoke of a passage through life, through good times and bad, with the Good Shepherd as our guide and guardian, and an eternal home at the end of the journey. There were many meaningful conversations, some of them tearful, with people who were able to make the connection between their own life experiences and the green pastures and the dark valleys of the psalm. This was scripture in action and a striking demonstration of the power of the Word of God in the lives of those who in their everyday lives might pay little or no attention at all. For many, the idea that part of the Bible could speak into their lives today was a revelation. God's word is enduringly powerful. Yet sometimes we need to find new ways of making it heard. I thought that was a real encouragement. So God is at work in our wider world, in creative ways as well as the more traditional ways, and here in our community in Christchurch and in our town. So may God give us more confidence in the power of the gospel, the good news, as we trust God to increasingly work and change us, and through us bring life and hope to our needy world.
Thank you, Mary. That's the second time I've heard Mary's talk this morning, and I was hugely encouraged the first time, and I'm encouraged again to hear that message of that the good news is for our life. The good news is for living. We're going to get a chance in a moment to respond in song, but I just want you to think about what a transformed life is to you. Jesus saved us. We live by faith. This is what that scripture that Mary spoke about. The righteous live by faith. It's because of what Jesus did for us that we can have God in our hearts. But the righteous live by faith. We walk through the valleys of darkness and the green fields. That's what life is. We're going to sing a song in a moment. The band's going to come and help us. It says, "Be my everything." And as we sing this, I'd like you just to say, well, what is everything for you? What does transformed life mean for you right now, this year? Be my everything. The righteous live by faith. How does God want to help you live this year and next? Let's worship.
God in my name.
So, Father, we give all those things to you. We give every area of our life to you, that you might transform it, that we may know life to the fullness, even in the dark days. Father, we know the cross. We know the cross is available for us every day, that we can cast our cares on you. And Father, as we do, we give us the fullness that you promised us, the fullness of life today. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. As Mary was speaking, I was reminded of a phrase I heard when I was much younger than I am now. I don't know, it didn't seem to have too much resonance in the first service, but I thought I'd try you out as well. Have you heard the phrase, being a Christian is not pie in the sky when you die, it's steak on your plate while you wait? You heard that? Not heard that? That doesn't really translate if you're a vegetarian. But what God asks us to do is to live life, and involve him in our lives. And we do that in many ways, and in prayer, he asks us to petition him for all our needs. So Louise is going to come and help us to petition.
Dear Lord, we just thank you. Thank you that you are a loving and amazing God. Thank you that you are the one who saves the world, Lord. Thank you for your good news. Thank you for our confidence in your gospel. Thank you, that we have such a message to share with other people, Lord. I'm going to ask everybody to do something. You're going to start to regret me coming to the front. If everybody can find somebody to sit, make sure you're sat with somebody, and we're going to pray together. I feel a sense that we're not feeling this confidence. Maybe you haven't experienced God. Maybe you haven't experienced him in a while. So just going to ask everybody to make sure you're sat with somebody, please. If you're on your own, then have the confidence to find somebody else on their own so that they feel encouraged as well. Thank you. We're just going to spend a few minutes, maybe with your hand reached out, or if the person next to you is comfortable, with your hand on their shoulder. Please don't be afraid. This is nervous for me standing up here guiding you to do this. You may be nervous but being about to do it. We're just going to pray for them, ask God to give them blessings and an encouragement. Your thoughts might start to wander while you're doing that. That's fine. Let that happen. Don't say, I'm not thinking about the right thing. I shouldn't be doing this. And we're just going to wait. And good thoughts for that person are likely to start to come to you. Okay? And then we will have a little opportunity to share with each other. I'm going to keep talking you through it. That's because this is normal and this is okay. Okay? So if you want to start by thanking God for that person, if you know their name, or if you just want to thank you for his precious child. And then you might want to ask God to fill them with a sense of his peace or his joy. If you're the one praying, you might want to keep your eyes open while the other person receives the prayer and encouragement. It's all right to not have many words. It's all right to just sit and listen to what God might be telling you. We're just looking for good things, things to encourage the other person. And if a thought just comes into your head, don't doubt it. Don't make it about you. It's God is working, okay? And then if you haven't prayed the other way around, then if you want to pray for the other person, thanking God for them and praying his joy and peace over them. And if you're not sure what to pray or what to think about, you might just want to pray the words, Jesus, Jesus, or thank you, Jesus. Maybe you have something that you want to share with the person you've been praying for, a word of encouragement, something good that you think they need to hear. If you're not sure about whether to share it, then share it, because that person is going to feel so much better if they hear it from you than if you hold on to it. If you're still praying, that's fine, keep praying. But if you feel like you've got something, then please do encourage them with it. And as the children start to come back in, don't worry about that either. It's all right for them to see us praying for each other. Lord, I just thank you for your words here to us this morning, Lord. I just thank you that you want to meet with us. I just pray you would equip your people with your joy, your peace, and your confidence this morning. Pray that we would go from this place feeling a little bit lighter. Lord, how can we go if we don't feel that confidence? How can we go if we don't know it ourselves, Lord? Would you reveal more of yourself to us this morning and in every day of our lives, Lord? Thank you for Christians all around the world, Lord. Would you inspire them as well? Would you give them encouragements that they would continue to share your good news, Lord? Help them to come back to you for their strength, Lord, and their peace. As I was praying over the service, I had this picture that maybe we try and look at the world with a backdrop of light, but instead, if you look at it as a backdrop of a black piece of paper, as in the beginning when there was nothing, and then you pick out all the good things that have happened this week, all the things that God has been doing around the world, then it suddenly looks a very bright piece of paper. I think sometimes, if we're honest, we're looking at a bright piece of paper and we're broken by all the dark bits that appear on it. There will be a bright piece of paper that is on its way. The dark piece of paper is going to get brighter and brighter, but the backdrop is dark. I don't know if that's helpful for anybody. Just going to spend another minute in quiet and then we'll close. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe you want to pray for your young people as they're coming back to sit with you. Lord, they're coming back with joyful faces. That's wonderful. Lord, would we capture some of their joy? Would it pour out into this room as they return to meet with us, Lord? Just pray for more of your joy. More of you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Well, amen. I'm going to give you a couple of notices now before we move towards the end of our service. And I have four notices actually. One of them is related to the APCM meeting, our annual parochial church meeting, and it's on the 18th of May, 7:45. Today is the last day if you want to vote on that evening for various things. Today is the last day to register on the electoral roll. On the night, there are three openings, three vacancies. One is a PCC secretary, another one is a PCC trustee, and then there's a PCC deanery synod representative vacancy as well. Martin is with us for two more weeks. His party is on the 21st of May. And tickets for all that will be available this week. So come along and celebrate Martin's retirement and moving on to different things. And lastly, there's a mum's night this week, 12th. This Thursday, the 12th of May, doors open at 8 for a 9 o'clock kickoff. I'm reliably informed it'll be a very casual environment. I think lounges are in the air. I think maybe I heard a rumour of wine, but that might be available too. But relaxation is the key, I think, key theme of the evening for women to come in and be with each other and share. I have two wedding bands. Very rare that I get a chance to read wedding bands, so I'm going to do it hopefully correctly this time. As compared to the first time this morning, the wedding bands for Simon Lee Lane and Georgia Rebecca Harris of the parish of Christchurch, where they're being married in St John's Epping on qualifying connections, and this is the second time of asking. So, if anyone has any objections. And secondly, another couple, Sean Luke Beavis and Kennedy Rashma Hare. They both of St. Faith's Parish in Hitchin, being married here by qualifying connection. Again, for the second time of asking, if there's anyone who objects to them being married, please declare it. So let's pray for them. Father, we just lift these two couples to you. May they know the sanctity of what they're doing, the commitment of one to each other. And may they know where that comes from, where that commitment for one person to another comes from. It comes from you, Father, and we thank you for that commitment. And we pray more and more that these two couples will know that commitment between each other and between you and them also. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, moving to our final song, and the band is ready to go, so shall we just go? Let's go.
Of the Lord's on his face. We hope you've enjoyed being with us as we've gathered here together this morning. And if you want to find out more about reading the Bible, why don't you also check out the Bible Project and its opportunities? But let's now remain in God's blessing this morning for a little while longer. And so may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you now and always. Amen.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. When the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. Oh, my God will never fail. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the There is power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. 'Cause I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. You will take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. So I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Thank you.